Welcome to Worship with Christ Church. On this first Sunday of a new series that we're doing, as we're looking at how the worlds of film and faith intersect. We're going to be over the next four Sundays looking at four different films, starting today with the movie The Grapes of Wrath, a 1940 classic, one of the greatest films ever made. And we're going to be looking at that, of the lessons for faith that come out of that, how Scripture speaks into that, and even how that speaks into Scripture and into our lives. So we're going to be doing that. Encourage you each week to see the film prior to that Sunday. So I hope you got a chance to watch The Grapes of Wrath this week. This next week, we are going to be looking at the Disney Pixar movie Up. Probably a little bit easier one to find, to be honest, on Disney Plus and find at the library and probably if you just ask some neighbors who might have it on disc. I encourage you to watch that leading into our time together next Sunday. I want to let you know, a week from Tuesday, so June 21st, we're going to be having a night together at the church. We're going to be cooking out some burgers and some hot dogs and stuff like that and having kind of an intergenerational fun night around the movie Up. So we're going to have some things for kids specifically. We're going to have some things for adults. So come, have dinner, and then stay for the time afterwards. There's also going to be some more mission opportunities coming up in the coming weeks, so we'll be sharing more about that. And then probably next week we're going to be sharing a little bit more about some changes coming for our Illumination Youth Ministry program. And so some doors that God has opened that we're very excited about. So that is coming up as well. Friends, I'm glad that you are here today. I'm grateful for you. We're going to open today with actually the very ending of the movie The Grapes of Wrath, because the words that Ma Jode say at the end of the film really capture a lot of the heart of that film and capture a lot of where we're going to be looking at today. So we enter into worship with that. We pray that God meets you in a very real, very powerful way today. Grace and peace and love and joy be with you as we worship together.
20 days work. Oh, boy.
I'll be glad to get my hands on some cotton. That's the kind of picking I understand.
Maybe. Maybe 20 days work and maybe no days work. We ain't got it till we get it.
What's the matter, Ma? Getting scared?
Scared? I ain't never gonna be scared no more. I was, though. For a while, it looked as though we was beat. Good and beat. Looked like we didn't have nobody in the whole wide world but enemies. Like nobody was friendly no more. Made me feel kind of bad and scared, too. Like we was lost and nobody cared.
You're the one that keeps us going, Ma. I ain't no good no more, and I know it. Seems like I spend all my time these days thinking how it used to be. Thinking of home. I ain't never going to see it no more.
Well, Pa, a woman can change better than a man. A man lives sort of, well, in jerks. Baby's born or somebody dies and that's a jerk. He gets a farm or loses it and that's a jerk. With a woman, it's all in one flow like a stream. Little eddies and waterfalls, but the river, it goes right on. A woman looks at it that way.
Well, maybe. We sure taken a beating.
I know. That's what makes us tough. Rich fellas come up and they die and their kids ain't no good and they die out. But we keep a-coming. We're the people that live. They can't wipe us out. They can't lick us. We'll go on forever, Pa, because we're the people.
Mention at the beginning why I am where I am. I'm actually out underneath a little shelter at one of the parks near where I live, and it kind of fit with the theme of what we're going to be looking at, the theme of shelter, but also in the background that way, so kind of behind where the camera is a railroad track, and we're going to be talking about the lives of displaced persons and their experiences, and what Scripture speaks into that, what we saw in the film, on the Grapes of Wrath. And so I felt like kind of this combination of the shelter here and that the train tracks over that way kind of fit that. Just to let you know, if a train comes by, we may just like stop and just pick right back up. So if you see a few little weird jump cuts, it's just because a train went by and it's really loud. So anyway, our scripture reading today comes from the book of Joshua. Very first words of the book of Joshua, from chapter 1, verses 1 through 9. After the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord spoke to Joshua, son of Nun, Moses' assistant, saying, "My servant Moses is dead. Now proceed to cross the Jordan, you and all the people, into the land that I'm giving to them, to the Israelites. Every place that the sole of your foot will tread upon, I have given to you, as I have promised to Moses. From the wilderness and the Lebanon, as far as the great river, the river Euphrates. All the land of the Hittites to the great sea in the west shall be your territory. No one shall be able to stand against you all the days of your life. As I was with Moses, so I will be with you, and I will not fail you or forsake you. Be strong and courageous, for you shall put this people in possession of the land that I swore to their ancestors to give to them. Only be strong and very courageous, being careful to act in accordance with all the law that my servant Moses commanded you. Do not turn from the right hand or to the left, so that you may be successful in whatever you do. The book of the law shall not depart out of your mouth. You shall meditate on it day and night, so that you may be careful to act in accordance with all that is written in it. For then you shall make your way prosperous, and you shall be successful. I hereby command you, once again, be strong and courageous. Do not be frightened or dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable and pleasing in your sight, for you, God, are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. So, I remember when I was maybe 10, 11, 12 years old, thinking about movies made in like the 1940s and thinking, oh my gosh, those are like 40 years old. They're so old. And then someone this week I saw on social media shared about how movies made in like 1982 are as old today as movies made in 1940 were back in 1982. I was like, oh, okay, I'm old. Anyway. We're talking about a movie today, made in 1940. Movie 82 years old. One of the greatest movies ever made. A movie called The Grapes of Wrath, based on the John Steinbeck novel. And it's a film that, when it came out, was lauded, was nominated for several Academy Awards. It won for Best Director, it won for Best Supporting Actress. And it's a movie that has stayed with us through those 82 years. And it's a movie that is as relevant today as it ever was. It's a movie that tells the story of a family, of actually several families, a group of people going from Oklahoma in the middle of the Dust Bowl and the Great Depression, setting out with everything they had out to try to find a new life in California, encountering trials and difficulties along the way, encountering discrimination because of what they were, where they were coming from and what they were trying to do. Coming into camps where they had not did not have the basics and the necessities of life. I mean, all of these things that were experienced by people in the time of the Great Depression, the great end of the Dust Bowl, and so forth. While it's a fictional story, it is a story of truth. A true story of what people experienced in those days and times. And so it is easy, because it was made in 1940, to kind of just write it off. But the reality is, it is a story that has been told over and over and over again. It is a story that's being told right now. It's a story that's being told right now of strength and courage, of people fleeing and trying to find a new life, fleeing from Ukraine because of the Russian invasion. It's a story of Syrian refugees risking everything to get onto overloaded rafts to cross the Mediterranean, hoping to find welcome on the other side. It is a story of the strength and courage of the thousands who gather on our southern border in the United States every single day, who have traveled thousands of miles from Central and South America in the faint hope that they will find asylum and refuge and shelter in the United States. It is the story of those who fled from the genocides in South Sudan and in Rwanda. It is the story of the courage of those who fled the Bosnian War to find refuge in places as far away as Fort Thomas, Kentucky and Sioux Falls, South Dakota. It is the story that has been told about Cambodians in the 1970s. It is the story about those who fled Nazi Germany during World War II, Jews and others who the Nazis considered to be undesirables. It is the story of people like the Jodes and so many others who set out from the Dust Bowl and headed west to try to find new beginnings. It is the story of those who fled after World War I and the devastation that was wrought upon Europe. It is the story of ancestors such as mine, my grandparents and great-grandparents who left Poland to come to the United States seeking a better life. It is the story of many of our own ancestors who did the same. It is the story that goes all the way back to the people who Joshua was called to lead. A group of people who were slaves under the rule of a brutal pharaoh and ruler in Europe, in Egypt, and who left that country wandering in the wilderness for decades, hoping to come into the land that they were promised. And to whom in our scripture today we heard those words, be strong and courageous. Be strong and very courageous. Be strong and courageous, for the Lord is with you. This story of the movie In the Grapes of Wrath is a story that, as we've shared, has been told time and time and time again. It is a story that is central to the witness of scripture. Because time and again, Jews are reminded in the Hebrew scriptures of how that they were to remember that they were once slaves in Egypt. They were once those traveling, finding refuge. And so much of the ancient law that we read about in the Old Testament was tied to compassion for those facing similar circumstances. In fact, there's one whole book in the Hebrew scriptures, the book of Ruth, that is the story of a displaced family finding refuge in another country and then finding refuge once again back home. When you read through the laws in the Old Testament, you see time and again places where it speaks about forms of compassion and actions to be taken to have compassion upon the immigrant, the refugee, the stranger in your midst, are some of the different words that are used. And so as we had watched the story of the Grapes of Wrath, you know, when I rewatched it a couple weeks ago in preparation for this, I could not help but keep thinking of all of these other stories that I mentioned. Bosnia, Rwanda, South Sudan, Syria, Ukraine, our southern border, the list keeps going on, Jews seeking refuge during World War II. I mean, all of them, and seeing their story in the story of the Jode family. And also in that, remembering words that Jesus spoke. Words that Jesus spoke in Matthew 25, where he said that we, in what we do, the ways that we love other people, the ways that we clothe the naked and visit the imprisoned and feed the hungry and care for the sick. And while he did not specifically mention to have compassion on the displaced person or the refugee, I'm sure that was a sense in there, because Jesus himself at one point had been that as he fled from Bethlehem with his family into Egypt and then eventually returning home. But Jesus in Matthew 25 said that when we do these things, the clothing the naked and so forth, the compassion for the refugee, we are actually doing that to Jesus. We are clothing Jesus. We are visiting Jesus. We are having compassion upon Jesus. That's the call for you and me. Out of this movie, out of this scripture passage. And there's a dear friend of mine, is one of my classmates from seminary. His name is Kent Annan. Kent is the director of the Humanitarian Relief Institute at Wheaton College. And he wrote a book several years ago called You Welcomed Me. And in his book, at one point, he's talking about the Ugandan welcoming of South Sudanese refugees. They welcomed in over 1 million South Sudanese refugees during the Sudanese Civil War. And he said that one of the things he heard people speaking of was that their compassion was not just because, well, that could be me, but also it was, they are us. They are us. And he also said that when we do these things, these clothing the naked and feeding the sick and so forth, he says this, that in each person, in some mysterious way, we meet Jesus, and so we meet God. The Trinity in dynamic unity and diversity. Likewise, instead of seeing a stranger, we can learn to see another person with a kind of three-in-one vision. In that former stranger, we can learn to see the person, a fellow human in distress. We can see ourselves because that could be me, that could be you. And we see God through the mystery that in the other we meet the divine. So in our compassion to the stranger and to the refugee, we are seeing God. And when we think of those stories, and that's where I come back to that, those words from Joshua, the courage and the strength of those who fled those circumstances, who sought a new life, who knew that the chances of success, the chances of welcome, the chances of asylum, the chances of being brought in may be minuscule, but that was the choice that they made, that they had the strength and the courage to say, I am going to seek out this new life. I am going to trust. For many of them, I'm saying that they're saying, I am going to trust in God who has guided me to this point and will guide me further. That these words to Joshua are words that still speak to people today, to be strong and courageous, for God is with you even in the midst of these circumstances that seem impossible. That is where there is another truth in this. I have never had to face the kind of circumstance that a refugee, a displaced person from South Sudan has had to face, or those in Ukraine are facing right now, or those who are at the southern border are dealing with. I've never had that. But I know that I have had lots of circumstances and times where life has felt unsettled and unsure, and I've needed to hold to words such as these. To be strong and courageous, for God is with me. You know, and right now we are all of us in our world are in a time of unsettledness. Unsettledness about our government, unsettledness about the climate, unsettledness about the future, unsettledness about the economy. I mean, the list keeps going on and on and on. And so there is also a word in this for all of us, even if we're not a displaced person. We're not dealing with the circumstances that we've talked about this morning. But God says, be strong and courageous. Be strong and very courageous. Be strong and courageous, for I am with you. I will not abandon you. And so while that is a word for us, that is a word for me today, I hope that's a word for you and whatever you are facing in your life. I pray that it also is that which reminds us of the strength and courage of those who are facing circumstances far deeper than any of us are facing right now. That we may have the compassion, the love, the welcome, the care, to see that strength and courage and say, come, welcome. That we may be Jesus to them and they to us. May we have that spirit, as Kent shared, about seeing that three-in-one vision, that three-in-one vision of a fellow human in distress, recognizing that that could be us one day, and in doing so, seeing that through that interaction, we encounter the divine. Amen. As we pray together today, I do want to encourage you. I mentioned the book by Kent Annan in the sermon, a book called You Welcomed Me. I really cannot commend that book enough to you. Really exploring what Scripture says about our response as people of faith to displaced persons throughout the world, whether it's right here in our own country or whether it's across the world, about the heart and the spirit of what is in Scripture around that. Kent also shares out of his own experience in working directly with displaced persons in Haiti and throughout the world. So I encourage you, really take some time, pick that book up, and listen to those stories, because they're the stories of so many people in our world today. And stories of the people of Scripture, and the stories, as we saw in the movie, The Grapes of Wrath. So our prayer today is centered around praying for immigrants and refugees. And so let us pray. Oh God, you have given us in your word the stories of persons who needed to leave their homelands, Abraham and Sarah and Ruth and Moses. Help us to remember that when we speak of immigrants and refugees, we speak of Christ, in the one who has no place to lay his head, and in the least of his brothers and sisters, you come to us again, a stranger seeking refuge. And we confess that we often turn away. You have chosen that the life of Jesus be filled with the events of unplanned travel and flight from enemies. You have shown us through the modeling of Jesus how we are called to relate to persons from different nations and cultures, and you've called us to be teachers of your word. We ask you, O our God, to open our minds and our hearts to the challenge and invitation to model your perfect example of love. And God, we pray for the ways in which we each have journeys in our own lives into uncertainty, in the midst of unsettledness and fear. God, while we have this deep heart and compassion for the situations and lives of displaced persons throughout the world, may we also hold to that truth that you spoke to Joshua. That you will never leave us or forsake us, that you will be with us through all things, and that you call us to live as people of strength and courage, trusting in you. All this we pray in the name of Christ. Amen. So my friends, today go in strength and in courage, knowing that God goes with you wherever you go, but also go with a deep sense of compassion for people who are facing trials and struggles in their lives, knowing that we are called to be Jesus to them and to one another. Grace, peace, love, and joy be with you in the name of God, the Creator, Jesus, the Redeemer, and the Holy Spirit, the Sustainer. Amen.